Do you know that companies are paying a price for air pollution? That's right. About 23% of global carbon emissions are covered by a pricing system. What are carbon markets? What is changing right now? And what should investors consider? Let's break it all down right here on UBS Trending. Hi everyone and welcome to UBS Trending. I'm your host, Amantya Mukherjee. Today, my colleague Sebastian and I will discuss updates to global carbon credit markets and changes happening in 2024. Also, ideas for investors. Now, Sebastian, welcome to the conversation. Before we dive into this year, let's take a step back here, please. Can you please break down what are carbon markets and you know, what does this concept mean?
Yes, of course. Carbon markets are something that have already existed for quite some time, but it's something that has gotten more traction lately, has been in the news quite a lot, especially in 2023, and it's something that we're keeping a close eye on going forward. Now, the goal of carbon markets more broadly is to put a price on carbon. And what that means is that we're looking to make companies in some way pay for the pollution that they cause. Ideally, putting a price on carbon and making companies pay for their pollution is a way to incentivize or to encourage these companies to, over time, decarbonize their operations. Now, we see two main ways to do this. One is in a regulated way, which is where a government might put either a flat tax on carbon emissions, or maybe they institute a carbon trading system where companies are given allowances to emit, but if they go over their allowance, they have to buy more allowances either from other companies that were below their limit, or they can buy them at auction. And the other way that we see carbon markets, and this is where a lot of the news has focused in the past year, is on the voluntary side. Now, many companies may want to decarbonize or want to reach their own objectives to decarbonize. And one way to do that is by buying carbon credits in voluntary markets, so where they say, we're buying projects that are actively causing decarbonization, and we are going to take those to reach our own decarbonization objectives.
Thanks, Sebastian. Especially this last example you just gave of companies buying voluntary credits, another word for it is offsets that most people may be familiar with. There's lots of opinions around here, and these are very complex systems. Maybe one more thing I would add is, in a way, when we talk about putting a price on carbon, there's all of these systems. Carbon markets are just the financial markets that allow us to essentially trade what now becomes a security. And that's what we're going to look at in this conversation. Now, tell me a little bit more here. Why does it matter that governments or these markets are putting a price on carbon?
Yeah, so it's very important that governments find a way to put a price on carbon to actively incentivize decarbonization. Of course, some decarbonization that we're seeing in the market today is just by innovation, companies becoming smarter and optimizing their operations to really reduce their environmental impact. However, carbon markets are a way to further that development. And what we're seeing is that, as you mentioned before, already 23% of global emissions are subject to some sort of carbon price. What's important is that there are significant differences between these different markets. So on the chart, what we see here is, on the one hand, what part of the emissions in a certain country are covered by a carbon market. So for example, California and South Korea are countries where a big part of the emissions in the country are subject to a price on carbon. But then also the price, of course, has a big role to play in driving that decarbonization. So for example, the European market is one where prices are relatively high, even though only around 40% of the emissions in the EU are in scope. Now, what that means is, of course, that it helps companies in their planning looking forward, right? How do we take this price into account when we're planning for new projects? But also on the opportunity side, it presents something interesting where, for example, the proceeds from a market like this are used then to further drive sustainable development, like in California, where 100% of the proceeds from the carbon market are used for climate objectives.
Yeah, that's interesting. And California, the state here in the U.S. as well, not the U.S., is just a state-based emissions trading scheme, as you're also kind of hinting at. And what's interesting here is also that it's some sectors which are regulated, which are scoped in. And so those sectors will be things like power, utilities, transportation, aviation. In the EU, shipping was just scoped in as well. And these are the sectors where where pollution is an input or an output that is needed to be factored in from an economic sense. So this, in some ways, is a textbook of Economics 101 coming into play, informing these nascent markets. Now, with all of this background, why is this a trending topic right now in 2024? What's changed?
Yeah, so I think we saw a couple interesting developments, and two of those are in China. Now, China introduced its regulated carbon market, so its emission trading system, back in 2021. And what we saw that they introduced this year is to improve and increase the governance around that system. And hopefully some of the additional oversight and the governance will help with more visibility of the demand for the credits. But also what they did is that they relaunched their domestic voluntary carbon market. Now, the interesting bit about this is that part of this relaunch allows companies that are buying voluntary credits to use some of those to meet their regulatory obligations. And similarly, what we see is that other regions are following this example. Australia also has a similar scheme, and hopefully we see more adoption across the world later as well. Now, what this does is that it means that voluntary markets and regulatory markets don't exist in isolation, but instead that voluntary markets become almost pre-compliance markets.
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, it's definitely a step in that direction. And these conversations, even though for most everyday watchers or readers may feel new, have actually been going on since the 90s. So the world at large has been really doing a lot of trial and error on these questions. We mentioned California just because I sit here in the U.S., in New York, and California also introduced some changes that kicked in January 2024 with new requirements for those companies which are either producing carbon credits or offsets or those that are buying them to make claims of decarbonization. Now, the goal of these additional disclosures and requirements is directionally going in that same place to increase market trust. I mean, I, as an individual, whenever I go to buy a flight, I often get an opportunity to add an extra $3 or something to my flight to buy an offset. And as a consumer, it's difficult to know how credible that offset is. Now, the company offering that is really counting potentially on those proceeds to help decarbonize aviation. So what these governments are doing and these changes currently are helping really close that credibility gap, if you will, to increase transparency in the longer term. Now, lots of uncertainty here, but there are some pockets of the markets where we think enough evolution is happening for us to be able to put in client portfolios. Where are we seeing these opportunities, Sebastian?
Yeah, so the developments in the voluntary markets, as you mentioned, are encouraging, but we think that for now the primary focus will remain the regulatory markets. We think especially opportunities exist in the European and the Californian markets. California markets pricing was relatively stable in Europe. What we saw was prices really falling over the past year. Of course, as a result, primarily because emissions are a function of economic activity, and with slower economic activity in Europe, prices and demand were falling. Now, in the short term, this might lead to volatility as a result of economic activity, but hopefully over the longer term, we are still constructive that higher carbon prices should be a significant player in driving decarbonization objectives.
That's right. And even, I mean, even from a financial kind of instrument perspective, structurally, the way that the argument sort of is being set up, our views in CIO are that given that we still have a lot of demand for energy-intensive industries and those solutions that are more carbon light or carbon neutral are not quite yet mainstream, it means that companies in these industries will continue to emit carbon as they, you know, go about their regular business, aviation, utilities, power, think of these sectors, and therefore they will continue to need to access these markets to trade and cash in those carbon allowances. So again, this is the underpinning of the argument of our positive view here for the longer term. And we think it's an interesting opportunity for clients to consider whether they're interested in the financial sense or in the decarbonization aspects of it. So hopefully we'll have you back for more conversations, Sebastian. This is all the time we had today. And thank you for joining us. And thank you for joining us in this conversation. For more information, visit ubs.com/views. Make sure to follow UBS on social media, on LinkedIn, Facebook, Instagram, X, formerly known as Twitter, and also check out our Instagram channel at UBS Trending for UBS Studios content that you cannot find anywhere else. And as always, if you have any questions about your portfolio, please speak with an advisor. Until next time, I'm Amantia Muhedini. Have a great rest of your day, and remember to keep your eyes on what's trending.